Hello, and welcome to People of the Pod, brought to you by American Jewish Committee. Each week, we take you beyond the headlines to help you understand what they all mean for America, Israel, and the Jewish people. I'm your host, Manya Brashear Pashman. Matisyahu is a Jewish-American reggae singer, rapper, and beatboxer whose musical style and genre have evolved alongside how he practices and expresses his Jewish identity. But one thing has always been clear. He believes in Israel's right to exist, and he has expressed that repeatedly since the October 7th Hamas terror attack on Israel. Since then, he has performed in Jerusalem and Tel Aviv. He has performed for the families of hostages and for students at Columbia University as a show of solidarity for those who have faced a torrent of anti-Semitism there. But there are places where he has not performed, including Santa Fe, New Mexico, Tucson, Arizona, and Chicago, but not for lack of trying. Those shows were canceled by the venues because of the threat of protests. Matisyahu is with us now to discuss these cancellations and what's behind them. Matis, welcome to People of the Pod.
Hello, People of the Pod.
So, first of all, I want to introduce you to those in our audience who might not be familiar with your music. And we'll start with the anthem that I associate most with you, and that is One Day. Can you tell us a little bit about how that song came about, when and why?
Well, that song was written in around 2010, I want to say, or 2008 or 2009. And I was working on my second studio album. It's called Light. And we had turned in the album, and the new record executive didn't feel like we had any hits on the album. The album had been based on this story of Reb Nachman of Breslov called The Seven Beggars. And it was a bit of a concept album. And so I went to LA and I worked with a couple of writers and tried to write a hit song. And that's what we came up with, was One Day. And that song got used in the Olympics in 2010, Winter Olympics, on the NBC commercials. So that's kind of what propelled that song into popularity.
Popular, yes. But what does One Day mean to you?
A lot of my music is very positive and very much connected to this vision of messianic future of peace. You know, at the time I was very religious, and in my particular group, Chabad, Hasidim, the idea of a Messiah was very prevalent in the philosophy. I was living in a space of a vision of a future where, you know, the wolf lies down with the lamb and people, you know, turn their weapons into plowshares. And that was the thing that praying for and trying to envision daily. And so that was the main message of that song at the time.
Now, it's certainly something we've always needed, especially now. You grew up in White Plains, New York, in the Reconstructionist tradition, I believe. You found your way to Chabad. Can you talk a little bit about where you are in your spiritual journey now, these days?
I went through a very, very like intense relationship with Orthodox Judaism, Hasidus. I started from a home from a Reconstructionist background, so not Hasidus for anyone who doesn't know these terms, but more of a Reform kind of background. And went to Israel when I was 16 on a conservative trip where I spent 3 months there, which had a profound effect on me. And then when I was in college, about 20 years old or so, is when I started really exploring more Orthodox side of Judaism, and started out with the Karlbach Shul on the Upper West Side and his music and reading books about Shlomo Karlbach and the type of person he was and what type of work he was doing. And then from there, I pretty much jumped into Chabad and moved to Crown Heights and lived in the yeshiva there on Eastern Parkway for a couple of years, and all of that sort of prior to Matisyahu, the singer, coming out. And then I spent many years, within 10 years or so, sort of exploring Chabad and then Breslov and different types of Hasidim, different types of Hasidus, different philosophies within that realm. And I guess at some point, it started to feel a little bit not constructive for me to be there and felt more claustrophobic. And I felt I was not really connecting so much anymore with a lot of the ideas and a lot of the rules. And so I started to just kind of live more of a normal life, I guess, or a non-religious life, and still doing my music and making my music and writing from a place of deep Jewish yearning, empathy, and hope, you know, and using lots of the canon of the Old Testament still to use as metaphors in my lyric writing and stuff like that, but more focused on more of a humanistic kind of approach to the world, less concerned with my religion or God or being Jewish, and more concerned with, you know, writing about being a father or a husband or dealing with addiction or dealing with loneliness or dealing with different ups and downs of life. So that for me was a process going through that over the last maybe 15 years or so. And then after October 7th, you know, I mean, I've had some issues before, like in 2015 with the BDS, I was thrown off of a festival. And so there again, I felt like a very strong sense of Jewish pride when that happened. And especially like when I went to Israel after that had happened, I felt this sort of new connection with Israelis in the sense that a lot of them, writers, singers, actors, whoever, get shut down when they go overseas to try to perform. And so I felt like I had a strong connection with them and understanding of what some of them go through. And I guess that only reinforced my connection with Israel. Then after October 7th happened, it's been this very strong pull back towards feeling very Jewish and feeling like that is the center and the core of who I am. And especially right now, that's what feels the most powerful and authentic to me.
So you've been to Israel since October 7th, performing for soldiers on bases, hospitals, visiting some of the kibbutzim targeted by Hamas, the Nova Festival site. Did it scare you to walk those sites? I mean, can you share how you felt or what you took away from that experience?
I don't know that I was scared when I was there. I was obviously touched profoundly by the stories that I heard and what I saw firsthand. So it was more a feeling of just destruction. And then just seeing these incredible human beings that had just survived and are just the most amazing people. And then there was this feeling of hope and this feeling of, wow, look how these people come together and how I'm a part of that. And that became really a strong place for me in terms of finding hope for my tour and going out into America and dealing with cancellations and protesters and stuff like that. So I really wanted to try to grab that feeling that I had when I was in Israel and sort of bottle it up and take it with me and sort of get drunk on it at my shows with everybody and make everyone feel like there's a place where they can feel comfortable to be Jewish and they can feel okay with being a supporter of Israel.
Do you feel that your colleagues in the music industry understand that and understand where you're coming from?
Well, some people seem to silently understand it, and I'll get some texts and stuff from some people here and there. But no, I don't think people do. I think there's really, for the most part, as you see, the mainstream art world and music world either doesn't know where they sit or they're not supporters of Israel, you know.
Do you think if they went to Israel, they would have a different perspective on that, that it would shift that mindset?
Absolutely. I mean, any person in my band who's ever come to Israel, been with me, who's not Jewish or is Jewish but has had no connection, like didn't have parents or grandparents that taught them about Israel, or, you know, didn't have that experience of going to Israel like I did when I was 16, I think anyone who goes to Israel feels the connection to this. And especially now, you know, there's no way to deny it, I don't think.
So is it important for Jewish celebrities in particular, or influencers, to speak out about the violence on October 7th?
See, I think it's important because it's important to me, you know. But what I've learned is there's no point in, like, getting angry at people, thinking that it should be important to them if it's not important to them. And if they're not speaking out and it's because of fear, then the fear is larger than how important it is to them, you know? And everyone has to deal with their own stuff, you know? But to me, it seems that the fact that there's such a lack of people speaking out is a symptom of a sickness that the Jewish people may have been carrying that just seemed dormant for some time, which is that somehow that it wasn't important to a lot of American Jews. So for me, it was just like tapping into what is the feeling after October 7th. And it was immediate, and it was like in my bones and in the depth of the core of my being, you know? And I feel very blessed that, like, on my journey in life, I was able to connect that deeply to being Jewish and to Israel and realizing how those things are connected. And I went on a journey, like, I didn't come necessarily from a place where that was instilled into me. You know, to some extent, it was, you know, but I went on my own journey and I spent a lot of time, you know, sifting through all of that and figuring those things out for myself. And so I feel blessed to be in the position that I'm in, where I know kind of who I am and what I believe, and people can take strength from that.
So I lived in Chicago for 15 years, so I'm very familiar with the House of Blues as a venue. I loved going to see shows there and was heartbroken to hear that the House of Blues canceled your recently scheduled show. I understand that they paid the contractual penalty. You're going to donate that to an organization that advocates for the return of Israeli hostages held by Hamas. But can you tell us a little bit about the conversations you had with them, or with Chicago police or anyone else, prior to the cancellation, and what explanations were given?
Well, I'll go into it a little bit. I mean, there's still some confusion as to exactly what happened, but I essentially got a call from someone high up at Live Nation saying that the show needed to be canceled because of lack of police force. And then with a friend of mine, David Draymond, who's a lead singer for a band Disturbed, also from Chicago, with a lot of his close friends, we were able to explore that. And it seemed as though the police department was aware there was going to be a protest, but that they were not concerned. So then it became a mystery as to where's the concern coming from, really, which then led us to this whole Elderman thing. And then we thought it might have been this one, but then it, you know, turns out maybe it was other Eldermen that were putting pressure on the police force or on Live Nation. And so there's some mystery. And honestly, like, as much as it is important to find out where this is coming from and so how we can try to stop it, it has not been my main focus this past week. This past week, I was out on tour. I played 4 shows. There were protesters at all of them, except one, Salisbury, Massachusetts. And all 4 shows went on, and they all sold out, and they were all really powerful. So what happened in Chicago was pretty devastating for us because, you know, it's scary to think that people, you know, are making choices and being able to shut down huge organizations and creative expression and artistic freedom. So it was devastating, but, you know, we bounced right back and jumped right back in a tour. And I got another big week of shows this week. So that's basically all I know, to tell you the truth. And while I would love to, like, point the finger and say it was this person or that person, what I'm learning is, as things start getting uncovered, you know, it's hard to know. I'm not an investigative reporter, but I'm sure that, like, you know, it's tricky finding out what the real story is. A full-time job, probably.
Were there similarly mysterious circumstances surrounding Tucson and Santa Fe?
No, that was less mysterious. And in those cases, it was a little more clear as to what was going on. In Santa Fe, it was like literally staff members that didn't want to come to the show and for whatever reason let the venue know at the last minute. There may have been someone at the venue behind that. We don't really know. And then in Arizona, it was seemed like it was more from the promoter or the buyer of the show where people were putting pressure on her to cancel the show.
You know, I asked you a bit ago if it was important for Jewish celebrities or influencers to speak out about October 7th violence. I'll ask you instead, is it important for them to speak out about this kind of cancellation or censorship or limitation on creative expression?
I think so, you know, because it's like that old story, like, you know, they came for me and these people and I didn't say anything. They came for these people and then they came for me. I mean, that's what we see out here. You know, that's what artistic expression, you know, creativity is about. It's about being able to express your views and your ideas through music. It's peaceful, you know. So it's unfortunate. It's what we have to deal with. There are people that realize how important it is. And those people like David are really like trying to help and trying to be outspoken. I'm feeling support from a lot of those people, but not enough for sure.
You know, speaking of creative expression, I am curious whether October 7th has influenced any of your musical creation, songwriting. How has that influenced the creative process for you?
One way, I have a song that's coming out. It's called Ascent, and I wrote it before October 7th, but after the Kanye anti-Semitic lash out. And it's about anti-Semitism. So while I was in Israel, we shot the video at the site of the Nova Festival and in some of the kibbutzim and with some of the survivors. So that is like one very obvious way in which I was influenced. And that video kind of takes footage from the Holocaust and World War II and intermixes it with October 7th footage as well. And then in terms of my own music, last year I recorded about 40 songs and, you know, started releasing them with this EP. But I kind of like right when all this began is right as I was starting touring. So it's sort of for me a different creative hat. It's like a bit of a different place than writing. So I'm not writing new material, but I'm performing the new songs along with old songs. And what I'm finding creatively is that a lot of the lyrics and a lot of the themes, even though over the years some of them have been personal, they all kind of connect and tie into the greater story of the Jewish people and the obstacles that we face and our survival.
That's one of the reasons why I brought up One Day is I loved the song back when it came out, but it does take on a whole new meaning when you listen to it today. It's very powerful. This is not the first time that your shows have been canceled due to anti-Israel sentiments. I believe it was in 2015, there was a music festival in Spain that canceled your appearance when you wouldn't promise to bring up Israeli politics on stage. Instead, you toured a dozen American college campuses that year. And I'm curious what you learned from that experience that you're applying to now, and also what you've learned on some of these college tours.
Well, that's a great question, because for a lot of people, all of this is the first time they're experiencing it. And I feel like part of the blessing of my journey that I've had is that I have gone through this to a lesser version, like you said, in 2015. What they wanted me to do was to sign some kind of document saying that I was against the atrocities of Israel. So I wouldn't sign that. And then that was the same thing. It was like, no, I'm not going to do that. That doesn't line up with like who I am. I don't care, honestly, what this statement is. I'm not going to sign something. I'm not going to be singled out as the only artist out of hundreds that's being forced to sign something because I'm Jewish or because of my belief system. So I just kind of played it cool. You know, I was just like, no, I won't do it. And they threw me off the festival. It was like the story of Purim. It was like they were trying to hang Mordechai, but like Haman got hung, really. It's like they basically were like patting themselves on the back, like we threw this guy off the festival. And then there was like an uproar about it. There were backers that were pulling out of the festival. And so they ended up having to apologize and asked me to come back and still play the festival. All this happened within 3 or 4 days. And so I did go back and I did play the festival. And then I went to Israel, you know, and then I went on this college tour, you know, with a Palestinian artist. And we went and, you know, performed together because that we felt that was an important thing to do. So I think from what I learned from that was sort of like this idea of sort of like trying to just be like water. Like if I just sort of do what I feel is the right thing and just don't kind of like lose my cool and I'm able to just sort of move within it, you know, then basically it's going to come out in a way that hopefully will be victorious. And that's been my strategy so far with this tour as well.
So my last question to you is, you know, we talked about your journey, your faith journey and your musical journey. What makes you Jewish and proud today?
You know, you see the Jewish people don't really give up. They're fighters. And there's always, in my mind, I believe, a vision of peace and a vision of hope and of empathy. I really truly believe that that is at the core of who we are. And that is what we are actually fighting for. Even when the rest of the world is trying to say that we're the monsters, you know, we won't let that stop us. Like, nothing will stop us. It's just who we are.
Beautiful. Thank you so much, Matis, for joining us. If you missed last week's episode, be sure to tune in for my conversation with Israeli filmmaker Shifra Soloveitchik about her digital initiative, Women of Valor, Women of War, portraits of individual Israeli women during this difficult moment in modern Jewish history. Thank you for listening. This episode is brought to you by AJC. Our producer is Atara Lakritz. Our sound engineer is TK Broderick. You can subscribe to People of the Pod on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or Google Podcasts, or learn more at ajc.org/peopleofthepod. The views and opinions of our guests don't necessarily reflect the positions of AJC. We'd love to hear your views and opinions or your questions. You can reach us at peopleofthepod@ajc.org. If you've enjoyed this episode, please be sure to tell your friends, tag us on social media with hashtag peopleofthepod, and hop on to Apple Podcasts to rate us and write a review to help more listeners find us. Tune in next week for another episode of People of the Pod.